Hello, and thank you for listening. My name is Tom Clendon, and I am the SBR online lecturer. All of my online courses include mock exams on the ACCA practice platform, as well as full WhatsApp support. Come and find me on the internet if you want to pass SBR with me. But today I'm talking about alternative performance measures. And this is a topic that is on the SBR syllabus. And I want to explain what they are, why we need them, talk about an example of them, and then to perhaps evaluate their role in financial reporting, whether or not they're really useful. So let's start by trying to set the scene as to these alternative performance measures. They're alternative. So they're outside the mainstream. And the mainstream is income statements, statement of financial position, earnings per share, segmental reporting. The mainstream is the heavily regulated financial statements that we produce and which are audited. Now, those financial statements are past orientated. Those financial statements are profit orientated. Those financial statements, some people regard as a compliance issue. They go through the motions. It's a tick box approach. Now, an alternative performance measure says, by implication, what we're providing from a legal point of view, from a statutory point of view, isn't enough. That we as a company, we as a reporting entity, want to give more information, alternative performance measures, which are bespoke to our business, because we want the user to have a better insight into our financial statements. So we have to be charitable and we have to acknowledge that alternative performance measures come from a place of wanting to satisfy information needs, come from a place of remedying the fact that the statutory information that is provided isn't necessarily wholly complete. So what sort of things are we talking about? Well, perhaps there's two broad categories. One is KPIs. One is sort of non-financial measures, which really give you an insight into the business model and the success of the business model, which you can't necessarily read in terms of the money side of things. So, you know, a startup company, an internet company, something like Facebook, is dependent on users signing up, is dependent on that growth of sales. That's what's driving it, that level of activity. So reporting on that, even traditional businesses like airlines, you know, it's interesting to know their seat capacity, how efficient they are at filling their aeroplane seats. Oil companies, how much oil are they producing? What's the barrel? What's the amount of oil under the ground that they haven't yet exploited their reserves? So there are sometimes alternative performance measures which are of a non-financial nature. But other alternative performance measures basically take either profit or debt, gearing, and slice it and dice it in their own particular way. Now, this is getting very dangerous because ultimately there is no accounting standard. Ultimately, there is no regulation on how these alternative performance measures are prepared. So users are faced with, are they credible? Yeah, but we'll come back to that again in a minute. Perhaps the most famous of all alternative performance measures is EBITDA, earnings before interest, tax, depreciation, and amortization. Now, that is not a line in the income statement. Any company that publishes EBITDA is doing it on a voluntary basis, is doing it as an alternative performance measure. And why are they doing it? Why is this fashionable? Why is this useful? Well, let me try and break it down and explain a little bit more. Arguably, taking earnings before interest is more comparable because you remove the distortion on the measure of performance, which is as a result of how the business is financed. You see, if we're all equity financed, there's no interest cost, there's no finance cost. If we're heavily geared, there is a finance cost. So if we measure the performance after interest, some companies appear to do better than others. The highly geared, the venture capitalist companies have a lower post-earnings interest, but that is a function of how they're financed, not necessarily a function of their performance. So you argue that EBITDA is useful because it's before interest, makes it more comparable. Before tax, because you can argue that tax is not the responsibility, it's not a judgment on the management. Tax is, for international companies, sometimes high, sometimes low, depending on which countries they operate in. So if you want to look at the efficiency of the business and the profitability of the business, maybe it should be before tax. It's an argument. Before depreciation and amortization means that we're moving more towards cash, but it's not free cash flow. EBITDA is not free cash flow. It's a totally different alternative performance measure. I think before depreciation and amortization is a reflection partly of the subjectivity of those numbers, partly of the non-cash flow of those numbers, but primarily because businesses grow in different ways. Businesses can grow either by acquisition, takeover, or organically by building up from the bottom. And so you can have two large businesses, and how they have grown shouldn't really be affecting their measure of their profitability. But it does, because companies that grow by acquisition have fair value adjustments and therefore more depreciation. Companies that grow by acquisition have goodwill and therefore have that impairment expense, that non-cash amortization, well, it's impairment really, but impairment expense going through the P&L. Whereas companies that grow organically, yeah, don't have that. So you can see that EBITDA makes your accounts look really good if you're highly geared and you grow by acquisition, because it's going to make your company profitability look better, especially as some companies also try and use EBITDA as a predictor, as a relevant, as an extrapolation. So they take EBITDA and they say, well, not only will have EBITDA, but somehow within that formula, we will take it before weirds, before unusuals, before exceptionals. And do you know what? Those exceptions almost inevitably are like losses, you know, bad debts, closure costs. And therefore, EBITDA is a profit measure, almost inevitably is like a bigger number. And, you know, it is argued that it's useful because it's more comparable. It's maybe it's more predictable, whatever. That's my little story on EBITDA. I did come across recently a suggestion that not only should we have EBITDA, but we should have EBITDAC. We should somehow measure performance before the coronavirus. And, you know, because the coronavirus for most companies means there's redundancy, there's reorganization, there's a lack of income, there's additional cleaning costs. It's been bad news. Not bad news for everyone, but it's bad news for. So to take EBIT and then add back and pretend that coronavirus had never happened. Well, I think that's just madness, because coronavirus has happened. It's not a one-off short-term blip. It has happened. And I think accounting should be about stewardship, responsibility, saying what has happened. So to try and pretend or let's measure profit as if coronavirus hadn't happened, I don't see the merit in that. I don't see the credibility in doing that. That's my judgment anyway. That's my opinion that I'm sharing with you. So we do have these alternative performance measures, and in a good way, in a naive way, they are useful to the users because they are perhaps a genuine attempt by management to give something that is bespoke to their business, that sheds a light, a deeper light on their business because of the shortcomings of the statutory accounts. So they're entity specific. You're seeing the business through the eyes of management. But I always, always think that alternative performance measures have to be taken with a pinch of salt because they're not defined by IFRS. They will lack comparability. They will lack rigor and reliability. There's just too much temptation for flattery, the opportunity of manipulating that so it looks in the best possible light. And they're voluntary, so you know they're not always adopted by people. And that business about their lacking credibility, there's no accounting standard. There has been some movement at the European level. European Securities Market Authority has come up with some guidelines. But they're guidelines, yeah, as to how, on a voluntary basis, you know, we can improve the quality of alternative performance measures. So, for example, and I don't think these things are controversial. If you are producing an alternative performance measures, you should define what's gone into it. You should explain what adjustments you've made to get to EBITDA. What have you added back? What have you adjusted for? And you should reconcile that to your earnings figure. You should provide comparatives for this year to last year. And you shouldn't go around chopping and changing alternative performance measures every year. There needs to be some sort of historical trend. That is clearly going to be useful to users because the ability to compare with other companies is going to be limited because they're bespoke. And if in any particular year a company decides to cease, arguably that should be disclosed as well. Look, alternative performance measures are on the syllabus. Alternative performance measures are part of real life. They are published by companies. So companies obviously believe in them. As an investor, as a user to the accounts, we need to look at them with a pinch of salt. Yeah, they can be useful, but it's all about the context. Thank you very much for listening. I hope you now know a little bit more about alternative performance measures. There are plenty of other recordings on my podcast about impairment. I've got interviews with other lecturers. But if you're interested in passing SBR, please, yeah, track me down through my website. And I look forward to speaking to you on another occasion. Thank you very much.